Sandy Williams, and I have the privilege of being Gladstone president. I'm pleased to look out and see many familiar faces, Gladstone loyalists of the highest order, but it's also fun to see some new faces. There's two words I'd like you to think about tonight, and you'll see how this weaves through the exercise that we've planned for you. The first of those words is discovery. Because discovery is the core mission of Gladstone. The second of those words, though, is a word I used to be a little embarrassed to use, and that word is cure. I used to be embarrassed to say we're searching for cures, because that's a kind of grandiose concept. Cures don't come about very often, cures for dread diseases. But it is at the root of what we try to do. And what we're going to illustrate for you tonight is the intersection between the discovery of which Gladstone has developed a premier operation to do that, discovery about how biology works, and our ultimate goal, the goal that motivates all of us, and I think the goal that brings many of you into the Gladstone circle, is the notion that grievous diseases like Alzheimer's, heart failure, deadly viruses that are currently unsolved can be solved and will be solved through science. So I have an illustration to show you, if I can get that to work. Here we go. So again, here's this word discovery, and this is Gladstone's core competency. I'm going to use some business language. I know many of you are leaders in business and industry, so I'll use your language a bit tonight. Our core competency is discovery of secrets of nature that increase our understanding of biology. And over the years, we've created a very effective system to do that. This is what's sometimes known as basic science or fundamental science. Its purpose is to understand how things work in our bodies, in our cells, and what goes wrong with diseases. And the premise is, without that kind of understanding, we'll never find the cures to serious diseases. Now, if this is our core competency, what is our product? Our product are knowledge, what I'm calling here knowledge assets. Each one of these arrows is meant to represent the discovery, a discovery that is accomplished by a scientist here at Gladstone or elsewhere as they go about their attempt to understand biology and disease better. So as we go along, we produce these assets. This is what we do, and these are very valuable. Most of these we give away. We put them in the public domain by publishing the knowledge that we have. A few of these are subject to patent controls. We'll still ultimately publish them. But this is what we do. Now, we do this in the nonprofit world. You know we're a charitable organization. So we do this without any expectation of financial gain, but it does cost money. And it costs a lot of money. This is a capital-intensive, labor-intensive kind of operation that we're in. And every one of these knowledge assets costs some millions of dollars to produce. So this is the nature of the discovery engine that we've created here. And you know, we could stop there. We could stop there and say, this is important. We're doing fine work. Some of you would appreciate us for what we do in this realm. And that is where some of our sister organizations do stop. These knowledge assets will be woven together out there in the community, perhaps to find cures, but this is a sufficient raison d'etre for organizations like ours to exist. However, I think we've come to a collective agreement among our scientists at Gladstone, and I think this is what has drawn many of you to wish to know about us and support us, that there's another dimension, that we really want to be more directive about finding the cures that society needs, that we need as individuals, for our families, for our friends. And that introduces a different kind of process. I used to think that the process of discovery and the process of finding cures was collinear, meaning the same sorts of things do both. I've come more recently to the conclusion that that's not actually how it works. You have to have these things. These are the raw materials for a cure. But to turn them into the cure, you need a different skill set, and you need different kind of organizations to come into play. We can't do this by ourselves. And here's where the for-profit world comes in, and some of you live and excel in that world. Once you leave the nonprofit sector, this knowledge needs to be woven into fabrics to create cures, largely by biotech or pharma companies. Medical device companies could be in there too, but I've simplified things. Some of the large biotech companies take on properties of what I've called pharmaceutical companies here. But several things happen. To go from knowledge assets to a cure, you need skill sets that are better developed in these organizations than they are in ours, and you also need money at logarithmically increasing levels. A knowledge asset that will become a cure will necessarily pass through from the millions of dollars per asset stage to the tens of millions and the hundreds of millions before it is approved by the FDA and becomes a cure. And this is the system that we live in. Now, what we'd like to do more effectively than has been true in the past is this, is figure out a way to take our knowledge assets and drive them up this chain to where they cross this threshold where the for-profit world and the investors who live there say, this looks like it's going to work. We're ready to put money into it now. And unfortunately, the current state of affairs is that most of these knowledge assets reside somewhere down here. And only very few of them come close to the to this line. And to make sure I haven't lost anybody, we're defining here a knowledge asset as a discovery that has the potential to be a cure. It's a long way from a cure, but it's an insight into how biology works or what might go wrong that looks like if we could just know enough and drive enough, it could produce this kind of outcome that we want. So this is what we want to have happen more often now. We need help to do that, and it's crossing this threshold that really becomes our contribution to what can be a cure. So tonight, we've got three of Gladstone's most eminent and successful scientists, and they're going to talk to us about how do we do this? And if I leave you with one message overall, what I want you to understand is that two things are essential if we're going to find cures to Parkinson's disease, Alzheimer's disease, Pick's disease, these unsolved things that plague us now. Ebola looms out there. All of these things that are threats to society and our lives, how are we going to cure them? You must do this, and we should never abandon our zeal and our determination to continue to produce more and more of these knowledge assets. But we also want to be creative and think about what are new ways in which we can act so that this gap gets filled and more of these assets work their way up where they really have the chance to become a cure. So that's my latest intellectual analysis of how things work in our biomedical world. And now we're going to hear from some of the stars who are going to tell us what fills that gap. So our first person will be Warner Greene. Biographies are in your program, by the way.
Actually, let me add my welcome to all of you. It's great to see you here this afternoon. Tomorrow, you wouldn't be here because you'd be at the Giants game, probably. Before leaving this slide, I just want to make one comment. It's very concerning what's happening in the United States now in terms of generating these knowledge assets. The United States is now the 10th, has fallen to the 10th position in R&D investment based on their growth, their GDP. We spend currently 0.2% of our GDP in the area of basic research. We're losing our competitive edge because we are not generating enough discovery, enough innovation in this area. And the federal government, of course, is stepping back. They are funding less and less. And that puts pressure on institutes like ours to find other sources of funds to continue the discovery. It is a very desperate time in biomedical research. I see the potential loss of an entire generation of young scientists because of this lack of funding for the basic sciences. And it is the basic sciences that drives the entire search for cures. But let me begin by talking a little bit today about HIV and AIDS. So where do we stand? 74 million people have been infected with HIV. 39 million have died. That leaves 35 million people still alive, most in sub-Saharan Africa, although 50,000 people in the United States get infected year in and year out. We have made dramatic advances against this virus. There are now 30 life-saving medicines that are really converting this to a chronically manageable disease as opposed to an acute death sentence. Unfortunately, about two-thirds of the people needing antiretroviral therapy in Africa have not yet gotten it. So it's really a distribution problem that we're facing there. Yet the epidemic continues to expand. Is there a cure for HIV/AIDS? There is not a cure at this moment in time. We can manage disease much like we manage diabetes, but we can't cure it yet. There is actually one person who's been cured, Timothy Brown, who has had the virus apparently eradicated from his body. It took two stem cell transplants to do that, and antiretroviral therapy for a period of time. But what we're really looking for is a simple, safe, and scalable cure for HIV that will be available to the entire world. Now, I want to take you on a voyage of discovery. This actually has happened in the last several years in my own laboratory. I have to say it's been amongst them, in my 30 years of science, this has been, without a doubt, the most interesting voyage I've been on. And each lab meeting, I would sit there and I'd see the data being put up and I'd say, are you kidding me? Is that the way it works? It was one surprise after another. But the question that we asked is a simple one. How do CD4 T cells die during HIV infection? That, of course, the death of the CD4 T cell is what causes AIDS. The dropout of that subset of cells, which serves as the immunological conductor of the entire immune system, that's what causes AIDS. So you might say, well, Warner, HIV infects the CD4 T cell. Yes, it does. And it will kill this cell. So isn't that how CD4 T cells are lost? That explains between 3 and 5% only of the CD4 T cell loss. What happens to the other 95% of the cells that are lost? It turns out that, in fact, HIV, the infected cell, somehow influences the surrounding cells in the body to undergo death. And we now know that there has to be a cell-to-cell interaction between these cells. So it has to be an intimate contact made between these cells. But it is the death of these bystander cells that really drives progression to disease. That was surprise number one, bystander cells. Surprise number two was, in fact, as we figured out how these cells were dying, it turns out that they're not dying by a simple process of programmed cell death. They are dying by a highly inflammatory form of cell death called pyroptosis, pyro for fire. And in fact, the cells are breaking down, their membranes form pores, and the entire cytoplasmic contents of the cell are dumped into the extracellular space. It turns out this process is initiated that these cells, these bystander cells, become abortively infected. Because the virus is moving into a non-permissive environment, the virus starts to reproduce itself and stalls. But what it stalls at is the level where it makes DNA. So there are little pieces of viral DNA in the cytoplasm. And what the host does, what the host cell does is say, oh my gosh, something is trying to invade me. I need to react and respond against that. And in fact, I need to commit suicide in order to protect the larger host. And indeed, that's exactly what happens. This DNA is sensed by a cellular sensor, and it activates a death pathway. So HIV/AIDS is not caused by a toxic effect of the virus itself. It's caused by our own immune system responding to the virus. That is a fundamental paradigm shift in the field, that our immune system is causing the disease. Now, this is the pathway. We figured out that this is a very inflammatory form of cell death, which for the first time links the death of CD4 T cells and inflammation into a single process. These are the two pathogenic signatures of HIV disease. Now they're linked in a single process. Now, indeed, the inflammation occurring can attract new cells to the zone of inflammation that then undergoes new rounds of abortive infection, death, and so it just becomes a cycle. It becomes a vicious cycle of whereby a gristmill, whereby the CD4 T cells are destroyed. So is there a possibility of interrupting this pathogenic cycle? And this is where it really got interesting to us. Well, it was interesting all the way along. But from a therapeutic vantage point, this got very interesting when it was clear that we could add an inhibitor of this key enzyme in the pathway of cell death and completely save the CD4 T cells from dying and completely get rid of the inflammation. So we could block this CD4 T cell suicide and pyroptosis with inhibitors against caspase 1. Now, got even more interesting in that the discovery to translation timeline could be markedly compressed when we found out that Vertex, a small pharma company, had actually already created a highly selective caspase 1 inhibitor and had already used it in patients. Now, they tried to test patients with chronic epilepsy, with psoriasis, and neither of these conditions were really, the drug didn't work well enough to be advanced to FDA approval for either of those conditions. But it was safe, and it was well-tolerated in humans, which is a huge leap forward, and it was very selective in terms of inhibiting caspase 1. So you can imagine, I contacted Vertex and started a discussion about their drug, and they were intrigued, but generally, pharma companies are very risk-averse. And so they said, we'd like to see some more data. So in fact, we went into an in vivo situation where we created mice with a human immune system and then infected these animals with HIV. And then we treated the animals either with their caspase 1, Vertex's caspase 1 inhibitor, or just the vehicle that was used to suspend the caspase 1 inhibitor. And in fact, dramatic proof in vivo that we saved the CD4 T cells when we gave them VX-765. All the CD4 T cells died in the presence of vehicle. And in addition, inflammatory cytokines were not produced in the presence of VX-765, but were produced in the presence of the vehicle. So an early in vivo proof that we could, interrupting this pathway, we could save the CD4 T cells. We were also looking at studies in monkeys. It turns out that over 40 species of African monkeys have been infected with their own HIV. And in all cases, due to the millions of years of evolution with their virus, the virus has become non-pathogenic, no disease. And in fact, it looks like, our early studies, it looks like that the evolutionary adaptation is to knock out this pyrototic pathway, controlling the host response to the virus as opposed to suppressing the virus itself, like we do with our antiretroviral drugs. So now the question, now we're in further discussions with Vertex. We have more data, and they have indicated that they're very interested in this study. They're encouraging us to secure monies for the two clinical trials that we would like to perform, one of the drug by itself and the other the drug with conventional antiretroviral therapy. This is all going to cost, we costed this out, these two clinical trials will cost $6.7 million. So we're now looking to certain foundations potentially for funding of this gap. But it's going to be very exciting if we could come up with a new therapy. Now, what are the potential applications of this therapy? One possibility is if that inflammation is contributing to maintenance or preservation of this latent reservoir where the virus hides. The latent reservoir is why we can't cure anybody of HIV. If, in fact, that the inflammation is driving the self-renewal of that reservoir, removing the inflammation may attack the reservoir, and this VX-765 or drugs like it could contribute to a cure for HIV infection. So we're very excited, and in addition, in the United States, we're seeing that people now, within the next year, 50% of all HIV-infected individuals in the United States will be over the age of 50. That's a great accomplishment. People are living longer. But we're also seeing that they are now suffering from aggravated aging. Some people are dropping dead of heart attacks at a much earlier age than expected. Others are developing arthritis. Others are developing liver, kidney disease, dementia, cancer. And we think that this low-level inflammation that continues despite antiretroviral therapy may be driving that aging response. And again, this drug might be useful to prevent that low-level inflammation in combination with antiretroviral therapy. So we might actually alter the natural history of antiretroviral-treated HIV infection. Let me just leave you with one. I know that many of you, and I'll be happy to answer any questions you have later in the panel discussion about Ebola. Ebola is in the news. It might surprise you to try and put the Ebola outbreak, and not to diminish it, but to put it in perspective. Within one day, more people die of HIV/AIDS than have died so far in the entire West African outbreak. Within 2 days, more people die of HIV infection than have ever died in the entire history of humans of Ebola virus disease. So just to put, you know, the perspective that Ebola is a deadly, mysterious virus that obviously none of us want to become infected with. But from a numbers point of view, there are many other viruses that are much more lethal, including HIV, measles. I mean, I could go on and on about influenza, about those viruses. But I will stop there and close this because the other two speakers aren't using slides. And to introduce, would you like to introduce me? Benoit Bruneau will represent the Cardiovascular Institute in the next presentation.
All right, thanks, Mark.
Okay. All right, well, welcome everybody as well. Thanks for coming. It's a fantastic crowd. And I have the pleasure to stand up here and tell you about some of the work that we're doing here at Gladstone to combat cardiovascular disease. And I want to tell you about two kinds of heart disease. Congenital heart disease that affects children, and acquired heart disease that affects adults. And what I'm going to tell you about is mostly a discovery story about how in studying one of these diseases, we've been able to find a potential cure for the other disease. And I won't tell you which one is which right off the bat. And it really is a journey of discovery, and one that's really involved many of the labs up on the fourth floor in GICD. So first, the number one killer in the Western world is still heart disease. And by heart disease, I mean mostly heart attacks. So when there's a coronary artery that feeds the heart that all of a sudden blocks off, and there's a part of the heart muscle tissue that dies off. The good news is that because of advances in surgery and treatment, cardiologists have been able to increase the survival rate of heart attacks. There's more and more people who will have a heart attack but will survive it. And there's public safety measures such as putting defibrillators in public places and things like that that have really helped. But the problem is that of everybody who survives a heart attack, they have a large portion of their heart muscle that has now died off, that is no longer functioning. So the pump function of the heart is diminished. And what that leads to is for every single person who's had a heart attack, it leads to rhythm defects, and it eventually leads to heart failure. For example, my father had his heart attack at the age of 43, a couple of years younger than I am now. And right now he has a pacemaker defibrillator that keeps him alive once in a while. But his heart is gradually failing. And so it's one of the biggest unsolved clinical problems in cardiology is the failing heart. And we don't have a solution to deal with this right now. There are millions of Americans that are affected, and it's something that's really not stopping, and it's actually an epidemic. And so we really want to do something about this here at Gladstone. And before I tell you what we're doing about it, I want to tell you about the other disease that we're studying, which is congenital heart disease. Very different kind of disease. Congenital heart disease is the diseases of the formation of the heart. So 1% of children, one out of 100 live births, a child is born with a structural defect, a hole in their heart. It is the number one cause, the number one non-infectious cause of death in the first year of life. It's really quite tremendous. There are more deaths due to congenital heart disease than there are diagnoses of pediatric cancers. It really is a serious problem. It comes in many forms. There are many different severities. It turns out my daughter was born with a hole between her ventricles. It was a moderate size, and we're fortunate that it closed by itself without significant sequelae. So we were on sort of on the mild end of that spectrum. There's a gentleman who's a partner at Google Ventures who's been blogging about his son's congenital heart defects. And he sadly announced this week that his son, who's 11 years old, died of complications of a third open heart surgery that this boy was undergoing for a very complex heart defect. So there's a wide spectrum of severities, and it really is something that affects families. One out of 100 kids are born with these heart defects. One of the really sad parts about it is that despite decades of research, we don't really understand how these defects arise. When our daughter was diagnosed with her defect at her 2-week checkup, my wife asked me, she says, how does this happen? You know, why does this happen? And despite having researched this for 15 years, having written a chapter in a book about it, the only answer I could give her was, well, we don't really know. We don't really know how it happens and what we can do about it. And that, to me, is profoundly unacceptable. So what are we doing to address this? Well, we figured that the best way to understand how a heart doesn't form normally is to understand how it forms normally in the first place. So if we understand all the right instructions that nature uses to put a heart together, we could then unravel it, pull it apart, and figure out why it goes wrong 1 out of 100 times. And so in my lab upstairs and in collaboration with other folks upstairs, we've been trying to decipher what we call the genetic blueprint of the heart. So what do I mean by the genetic blueprint? What I mean is all the genetic instructions that are deployed during the formation of the heart to tell a heart cell to become a heart cell and to then drive all the movements that a heart needs to undergo to form itself right 99% of the time. So what exactly, let me tell you a bit about what I mean by a genetic blueprint. And for this, I've got to take you to biology class for a couple of minutes. We have about 200 different cell types in our body. We have brain cells, we have hair cells, we have skin cells, heart cells, muscle cells, and so on. Each of those 200 different kinds of cells has the same genetic instructions. So each cell has the potential to instruct a cell to be any cell it wants. And so what happens in the embryo is that there are switches that are thrown so that a cell that's going to become a heart cell gets all the switches thrown in place so that it gets the instructions to become only a heart cell instead of a liver cell or a brain cell. And same thing, the cells that are to become the brain get all a different set of switches that are thrown to give rise to a brain cell. And so that's what we refer to as the genetic blueprint. It's those genetic instructions, those sets of switches that gets set so that you get a heart cell in your heart and you get your brain cells in your brain and that your organs form all together. So we're in the process of trying to figure out this genetic blueprint of the heart. Now, how do we use it to understand congenital heart disease? Well, it turns out that of the known genetic causes of congenital heart disease are genes that encode proteins that are involved in setting those switches. And so congenital heart disease is really a defect of setting up this blueprint of these switches that normally all fall, all turn on and off in the right place at the right time, getting thrown aberrantly. And so what we're doing in the lab, now that we have at least so far sort of a rough blueprint of the heart, we're trying to understand what happens when these switches aren't thrown properly, what happens to the formation of the heart. And in the last few years, we've made some really exciting discoveries in just understanding how the heart comes together. And then only in the last few months, we've really understood how at least one of those switches is directly involved in how the heart forms abnormally in congenital heart disease. So we're in this process of discovery right now, and in a few years, I think we'll know a heck of a lot more than we've ever known in the last 15 years about how the heart forms normally and how this genetic blueprint goes wrong in the cases of congenital heart disease. So that's sort of the progress that we're making so far. It's very early days in trying to even think of a cure for congenital heart disease. But in the process of understanding this blueprint, we had a crazy idea about 5 or 6 years ago. Collectively, many of us thought, okay, we're in the process of understanding all the instructions that nature uses to make a heart cell and to put a heart together. Could we, if we were bold enough, figure out what the instructions are that we could use, that we could harness to make new heart cells and fix a diseased heart? Could that even be possible? It was a crazy idea at the time because obviously a lot of people had thought about doing this. It seems like something obvious that one should think about doing, and yet nobody had succeeded. So we had one hint that it might be possible. Experiments that came out of our lab had shown that, at least in the embryo, we could take a few instructions, not many, 3 or 4, and drive the cells in the embryo that would be normally become bone or muscle and turn those cells into heart. So we knew that we could somehow influence cells to become another kind of cell, in this case a heart cell, exactly the cell type that we were thinking about making. So Deepak Srivastava's lab, right next door to us, was inspired by the success that another GICD, another Gladstone star, Shinya Yamanaka, the approach that Shinya had used to harness the power, the instructions, the blueprint, if you will, of embryonic stem cells to be able to take skin cells and turn them into what you all may have heard of as induced pluripotent cells, these cells that were made from the skin that are basically identical to embryonic stem cells. And so folks in Deepak Srivastava's lab thought, if we could use that approach, think about using the instructions that we know that make a heart cell, could we again take those sets of factors and push a cell that isn't a heart cell and make a new beating heart cell? And so it was a complete shot in the dark experiment. And I remember sitting in the room when the postdoc from Deepak's lab was showing the first success that he had. He'd taken, I think, 20 different kind of master regulatory factors and put them into cells called fibroblasts. These are the cells that are normally sitting in the heart, just sitting, giving structure to the heart. But then in the heart attack, those are the cells that make the scar tissue, that scar tissue that doesn't work, that gives you the impaired heart function. And he was able to show that with a tiny little percentage, that throwing in these 20 factors could turn on a gene that's normally turned on only in the heart. And we thought, gosh, this can't be right. This can't be working. And he worked at it, he whittled it down to three master regulators that in a dish, he could get about 20% of these fibroblasts that normally are not beating heart cells and turn them into what looked, for all intents and purposes, like heart cells that would have come from a heart. And we thought, well, that's absolutely fantastic, but can you use that to fix a heart that's had a heart attack? where there's a scar, where there's a permanent loss of the heart muscle, a permanent loss of heart function. And so another postdoc in Deepak's lab took on that task, and she worked very hard to inject these factors into the hearts of mice that have been given tiny little heart attacks, but very similar to what to the heart attacks that people get. And lo and behold, she was able to get new heart tissue, and she was able to show that this new heart tissue came from these fibroblasts, these scar tissue cells. So she had, in fact, been able to convert the cells that you don't want there, the cells that form the scar tissue, and convert them into new beating heart cells. Not only that, but when they measured the function of the hearts of these mice, the heart function, the pumping ability of the heart, the squeeze that you need to keep blood flowing in the body, was almost back to normal levels compared to the severe loss of heart function that were in the mice that hadn't received those master regulatory factors. So here was an instance where we were able to completely regenerate, not completely, but to regenerate lost heart muscle, something that had never been done before, in a heart attack, and regenerate heart function. And get this, the best part of it, at least for me, the best part of it, I think, is that this is a permanent restoration of heart function. So there's no need, it's not a drug that you have to take every day, it's not a surgery that you have to get done every 5 years, it's a permanent restoration of heart function. Now keep in mind, this is in mice. It works a certain percentage of the time, and it involves a gene therapy type approach. So this needs to get better. So what are we doing? So we're taking really a team approach upstairs to really attack this and the genetic blueprint in order to together bring together all the knowledge that we possibly have upstairs to these two problems. And so, for example, Sheng Ding's lab, who's a chemist, works on stem cells upstairs, he's been able to do this exact reprogramming, this converting these fibroblasts into new heart cells using only chemicals, only small molecules, drugs, some of them already FDA approved, without a need for a gene therapy approach. So now the dream is, can we take these small molecules, can we just put in a drug in the right place for long enough to fix the heart? And then pretty much every single lab on the fourth floor, my lab, Deepak's lab, Sheng's lab, Nevin Krogan's lab, Bruce Conklin's lab, Katie Pollard's lab, are all getting together as a team effort to really try to really fully understand this genetic blueprint of the heart. Now, we have sort of a scaffold right now. We have kind of an idea. But if we really want to use precision biology to understand congenital heart defects, and then to be able to know what exactly are all the right switches that we can use to regenerate the heart, we really need to understand everything. So we've got this broad team approach. But one of the really fun things that's going on is that, of course, we're not limiting ourselves to mice. Mice have hearts that are very different from ours. And so now what Deepak's lab is doing is that they're extending this approach, this gene therapy approach to regenerate hearts, to hearts that are more like ours in size and in function. And so they're doing this now in pig hearts. And pig hearts are, pigs are obviously very large. We don't just house them upstairs. We have special places. But so far, and the surgeries are more complicated and sort of challenging than what we can do with the mice. But so far, the results are encouraging. We don't know yet if it's really going to work. But the results so far indicate that what was working in a mouse heart is working in a pig heart. I should parenthesize that this is also spectacularly expensive. We're fortunate to have support from agencies like CIRM and NIH to do some of this work. But we're really relying on the generosity of a few donors that have expressed keen interest in seeing this really work. And so I'm going to leave you then with this notion that we've come through this pathway of discovery, studying two completely unrelated types of diseases, and in studying one, the path of discovery has really brought us to a potential cure for another, and this other one being the number one killer in the Western world. And so if it works, it's still a big if, but if it works, it's a complete game changer, and it really, hopefully, will change how we treat people with heart disease in the future. And so that's how we went from studying congenital heart disease through the genetic blueprint to a potential cure in regenerating hearts. Thanks for your time.
So as you can tell, we had some slides and now no slides, and the organizers want to keep this a little bit lively and entertaining, so I was assigned to do mine in pantomime, and I've practiced, but this didn't work out so well, so I'm going to just talk to you as well. But I'll spare you slides, although I have to say that Warner's slides were absolutely gorgeous, and the story is, of course, really exciting. So I direct the Gladstone Institute of Neurological Disease, which has about 10 investigators in it that focus on quite an array of different diseases that affect the central nervous system, which is made up of the brain and the spinal cord. And we work on dementing disorders, and the biggest one among those, of course, is Alzheimer's disease, but there are others like frontotemporal dementia and dementia with Lewy bodies. We also work on movement disorders like Parkinson's and Huntington's disease and other neurodegenerative disorders like Lou Gehrig's disease or ALS. And more recently, we've ventured into neuroinflammatory conditions such as multiple sclerosis. And really our idea is that if it affects the brain and is frequent and hurts bad and somebody has a brilliant idea about it, come to us and we will try to make it work. So these conditions are, of course, incredibly disabling, oftentimes not only to the patients themselves but also to their families. And they cost a great deal of money. So Alzheimer's disease alone is estimated to cost the US $200 billion every year. So the impact on society because of the chronicity of the disease and the nursing home care that is needed is really tremendous. Now, it has been incredibly difficult to develop effective treatments for these conditions, particularly treatments that aim not only at the symptoms of these diseases, but at the root causes. In other words, treatments that would actually prevent the diseases from eroding the integrity and the health of nerve cells. The reasons for this difficulty are quite varied and have to do with the complexity of the organ that is affected. The brain is arguably the most complex organ we have. And the long time frame over which these diseases unfold, it's estimated that most of them go on for decades before we even know they exist in a person, and the enormous diversity of the genetic and environmental factors that probably have to come together in a very unfortunate constellation in many cases to initiate the disease and then contribute to its progression over, again, many years. So for several years now, Gladstone has built a very highly effective program or engine, if you will, to tackle these extraordinary challenges. And I want to tell you a bit about its key ingredients and about why we think this puts us into a unique position to conquer these devastating diseases of the brain and spinal cord. So first, I think one strategy that we use to great advantage is to place physician scientists who know these diseases inside out right next to basic scientists who have a very deep knowledge of the brain regions and their functions that are eroded by the diseases that we study. And we put these folks in places with mechanisms that really maximize their interactions that lead to mutual education and to the joint development of extraordinary ideas that ideally are unorthodox and challenge well-encrusted dogmas. Just to give you some ideas of some of the trailblazing ideas and discoveries that have emerged from this discovery engine that we've built, I should mention that we've discovered that some of the abnormal protein deposits that are typically found in the brains of people with Alzheimer's or Huntington's disease actually do not cause the degeneration of the brain cells, but help sequester these proteins that are poisonous into garbage dumps, whereas if they're allowed to float around in the brain, they hit connections between nerve cells and take out memories as they go along. So that was kind of a change in thought and has led to some interesting paradigm shifts in the field. Our investigators have also challenged the widely held notion that APOE4, the main genetic risk factor for Alzheimer's disease, contributes to this condition by enhancing the deposition of amyloid proteins, which it clearly does. But our investigators have discovered that this protein also undergoes an abnormal cleavage. It's broken up into fragments that then intoxicate brain cells and impair their functions, and particularly brain cells that regulate the activity of others in a network. We also discovered that a protein called tau that is implicated in Alzheimer's and many other neurodegenerative disorders actually plays a key role in regulating the activity of brain cells and their communication with other brain cells, and that reducing the level of this protein can protect the brain against other factors like amyloid proteins and ApoE4 and keep those factors from harming brain cells. These surprising discoveries have culminated in very exciting drug discovery programs whose aim it is to develop better treatments for Alzheimer's disease and related conditions. And importantly, these programs have been so successful that they have attracted major pharmaceutical partners who are now helping us to advance the compounds or strategies that we've discovered into actual real therapeutics that you can give to millions of people for many years. We've taken a similarly unorthodox approach to multiple sclerosis, where one of our investigators has demonstrated that the disease is likely triggered by the seepage of blood products through broken blood-brain barriers. She has now discovered some very interesting new compounds that can block the process that this triggers, and we think that these compounds have the potential to greatly curtail the disability that can result from multiple sclerosis and related conditions. Our investigators have also taken maximal advantage of the phenomenal stem cell capabilities that exist within the institutes and that you've heard about already. They've used this technology to develop new human disease models and to identify new drugs for the treatment of Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, Huntington's, and ALS. These are all still in developmental stages, of course. Some of our latest discoveries with major therapeutic potential include the demonstration that transplantation of healthy new brain cells reverses learning and memory deficits in mouse models of Alzheimer's disease, that a protein known to cause frontotemporal dementia is also very intricately involved in Alzheimer's disease, that increasing the clearance of an ALS-related protein from neurons improves their survival, and that increased levels of a protein called Clotho can enhance a variety of cognitive functions in mice and in humans. So I'm extremely excited about all of these discoveries and want to emphasize that many of them were made possible by a critical chain of events. First, there was the recruitment of one or more incredibly gifted scientists, oftentimes enabled by a philanthropic support. The scientist was then embedded into a unique discovery-promoting environment or infrastructure that Gladstone has built. Third, supported by Gladstone or extramural support from the NIH or foundations or other sources, the scientist then went on to make a radical breakthrough discovery. And then fourth, and this is critical, Gladstone received an enabling gift that allowed the scientist to develop the discovery into a potential therapeutic strategy. And fifth, and then things get really big, supported by now a variety of funding mechanisms and a whole team of experts that are experienced in drug development, the therapeutic strategy was leveraged into an industrial partnership or taken directly into the clinic. And an example of the latter path was from my group, where we discovered that a widely prescribed anti-epileptic drug that I've mentioned here before, levetiracetam, may be useful in Alzheimer's disease. And right now, we're in the midst of a phase 2A repositioning trial that's going on right here on this campus, where we are trying to determine whether this drug indeed benefits people with very early stages of Alzheimer's disease. We're very excited about this. And again, it's ongoing. So I want to thank all the donors who recognized both the challenges and opportunities we encountered and who stepped in at the right moment to put wind in our sails or ammo into our cannon, so to speak, in our fight against these horrible conditions. What I told you today was really only
a very small selection of exciting things that are going on in the Institute, and I encourage anybody with a particular interest in neurological diseases or in the precious functions of the nervous system to come by and visit with us for an in-depth discussion and a tour of our state-of-the-art laboratories. And with this invitation, I end and thank you for your attention.
Yeah, we purposely held questions until now because now it's your turn. I think you've heard illustrated all the principles that I introduced. We need the engines of discovery. We have to create these knowledge assets, and you've heard how that process works. But that's necessary but not sufficient to drive the knowledge to cures, which are our ultimate goal. And you've heard different remarkable stories of how we're trying to do that second part. And now here they are, here we are, and it's your turn.
Put up a hand and we'll get a microphone to you.
I'd like to know if you can measure Alzheimer's progress in depth and a degree that, is there some chart, for instance, to tell you how badly you have it?
So if I understood your question correctly, is it possible to measure the progression of the disease in a person who already has it? Mm-hmm. And the answer to that is yes, you can. Probably the most accurate measure still is a clinical one where, you know, there are very elaborate neurocognitive tests that very nicely demonstrate, you know, the ongoing decline in a person in a rather predictive way. There are now also some measures that can be obtained radiologically, for example, magnetic resonance imaging can identify the shrinkage of the brain, particularly of certain memory centers, as it progresses over a period even of months. So over a 6 month period, there is a difference in the volume of memory centers in the brain that one can visualize and detect. And lastly, there are now also techniques to actually look for the deposition of abnormal proteins that we think are involved in the causation of the disease, particularly amyloid proteins and also tau, that build up in the brains of people with Alzheimer's disease. And there are now probes that can be injected into the bloodstream that find their way into the brain, and they give off a signal that you can measure with positron emission tomography or PET scanning and other kinds of techniques. So there are many ways to follow patients with the disease, both with what we call biomarkers and with clinical exams that are pretty sophisticated.
Dr. Bruneau, would it be reasonable to think of fibrosis in the myocardium as an adaptive response after coronary artery blockage, such that the fibrosis prevents myocardial rupture in a transmural infarction? And this process begins shortly after the event and proceeds over weeks. So I'm trying to get in my mind what would be the appropriate timing of introduction of stem cells in an area that had been infarcted and was undergoing fibrosis.
Yeah, that's an excellent question. The timing is really important. The experiments that I described were the rescue in it, and it wasn't introducing stem cells. It was basically, it's a gene therapy. It's introducing sort of molecules that can convert the fibroblasts into new heart cells. The key there was to catch the fibroblasts when they were in motion. So normally they just sit there and they just serve a scaffolding purpose. And as you point out very well, they're mobilized to create a scar so that you don't have a gaping hole in the heart and you just have this scar tissue. The challenges right now are manifold. One is to be able to, if need be, to catch the fibroblast as they're being mobilized. And sometimes that's too late. And so what we're going to need to be able to do is to be able to transform fibroblast cells that perhaps have stopped dividing and turn them into new heart cells. Now, the second challenge with that is that you don't want to convert every single fibroblast in the heart, because half of the heart is made of fibroblasts, and that's actually, it's important to give structure to the heart. So now you don't want to remove that structure. So there's a number of challenges that are going to be ahead of us, and they really come in two flavors. One is effectiveness of the approaches that we're going to undertake, and the other is delivery. As with anything cardiology related, local delivery and extent of delivery and timing of delivery is really important. And so we may have to pair up with device manufacturers, for example, to be able to accomplish those goals. Sandy, you want to add something?
I do. Your question and Benoit's answer raises two very important points that I'd like everyone in the room to appreciate about the so-called stem cell revolution. We do stand on the threshold of a new era in medicine where many of us believe it will be possible to regenerate damaged organs. I think it's easy for people to conceptualize that a liver or a heart has been damaged. You can introduce some cells. You put cells in there, and then they might regenerate the organ. I think that approach is likely to work only in specialized circumstances where the tissue being regenerated is very simple, like the hearing organ of the ear, perhaps macular degeneration in the eye. But where you get to complex organs like brain or heart, the tissue architecture is too complicated, and I think it's a very naive notion to think by shooting a few cells in there, the cells will know what to do. So this more sophisticated approach is not to use cells, but to take the cells that are already there, send to them the instructions that we've learned about the normal development of the embryo in the heart, so we recapitulate what nature does. So I think this is a fundamentally different approach to regenerative medicine, and it's one being pioneered here.
Back to the topic of Alzheimer's, do you have any suggestions of things we could do in order to prevent the onset of it, like exercise or diet, or is it pretty much all gene-oriented?
Well, you know, so clearly, I think people usually recommend, I mean, the physicians do recommend that one lives heart healthy, and physical exercise is great from many different perspectives, that one eats well, avoids, you know, atherosclerosis, and so on and so forth. I don't think that there is any proven way of preventing this disease. You know, you hear all these different fads of doing crossword puzzles and doing this, that, and or the other thing. And there may be certainly something to it. There are experiments that suggest that it might be. But there is no definitive proof that it keeps Alzheimer's away. And there are certainly some incredibly mentally active individuals who are, you know, who scientists and professors at major universities who've been struck down by this disease just like any other person. And so clearly, you know, being mentally active isn't enough to keep it away. And there are all these various snake oils that sit on shelves that people buy, and every patient we see is on a different concoction of herbs and spices and God knows what. And in reality, there is no proof that any one of them will really prevent Alzheimer's disease. What we need is really very effective medicines, you know, that are as powerful as the things that prevent HIV-related disease. You know. Nonetheless, go and exercise and, you know, live heart healthy. I think it's a good advice in general.
I want to thank you very much for this, doctors. We represent the West African country, Cote d'Ivoire, and our wonderful president closed the borders immediately. several months ago and got flack from the press. And the next day, we received an anonymous letter from one of the chiefs of Doctors Without Borders thanking us, for us to thank President Ouattara. And so we are keeping our fingers crossed that although we have neighbors on both sides with this horrendous Ebola, he wisely helped our country that we represent. But one of the things I'd like to approach is that you would contact, please, the press, because they are alarming people, with a particular regard to the New York Times. It is appalling. I don't know if they're trying to get the Pulitzer Prize, but it is just really an alarmist kind of propaganda that I think they've gone over the top on that. And I loved what you said about the tragic statistics of AIDS versus Ebola. And my second question that I'd like to put to you is that I do understand that there is a marvelous vaccine, and the drug companies are very reticent about putting money into an Ebola vaccine when they can actually, with all due respect, because we live with Alzheimer's, they are putting money into Alzheimer drugs. So, Dr. Greene, could you give me your opinion about that, please?
Thank you for your remarks. West Africa is the hot zone, three countries, Sierra Leone, Liberia, and Guinea. Fortunately, the virus has not spread to Senegal, has been declared Ebola-free. Nigeria, where they had early spread, was now Ebola-free. Closing the borders in many of these countries, I mean, one can understand it. Kenya has done that as well. But the borders really aren't closed because people can move easily between countries, not at checkpoints. I mean, I think all of the countries, the barrier countries around the hot zone in West Africa need to be super vigilant, on guard, just as we need to be on guard here in the United States. We had a kind of a talk on Ebola here back in August, and we talked about that, you know, this is it's a global world that we live in. We are globalized, that things that happen in Africa will, it's not unlikely that they would will influence events in Europe and in the United States, and that's exactly what we've seen. Now, in terms of therapies and vaccines, currently no antiviral therapy for Ebola. There are some experimental drugs that have worked well in monkeys. You saw the early deployment of ZMapp, which is three monoclonal antibodies grown in a tobacco leaf, research sponsored by the tobacco industry. Strange, but at any rate, the world's supply of ZMapp was quickly exhausted. There are other experimental drugs that have been used primarily in Nebraska and at Emory, the really high-level containment facilities. In terms of a vaccine, there are several candidates. Two in the United States that I'm aware of, one in Canada. But you're absolutely right. There's never been a business plan for pharma to either develop an Ebola medication or a vaccine. The size and scope of this outbreak changes that math. And so you see a number of academic organizations, federal labs, and even certain pharma. I think Johnson & Johnson just announced today that they're launching their vaccine trial with 250,000 doses in January. So you see, it's a sea change. We have never, ever seen an Ebola outbreak of this dimension. Usually Ebola would be 300 to 400 people infected with about 80 to 90% of people dying, but it just flashes and then it recedes. Probably recedes back into the fruit bat where it lives, probably latently. This outbreak is unprecedented. Yesterday we passed 10,000 known infections. I mean, and it's probably double that number, the 10,000 known infections. And World Health Organization is estimating that within the next 1 to 2 months that we could be seeing 10,000 cases a week. So the doubling time is decreasing. So it's a, and obviously the cases in Dallas have captivated the United States. But I have to agree with you. I mean, CNN 24/7 is just, Anderson Cooper winds up in Dallas. Unfortunately, the patients have already left Dallas for Emory and for NIH. It's, you know, I do believe that I think our news media does tend to sensationalize various events, be it airliners that become lost or Ebola outbreaks, not to minimize the seriousness of this epidemic. I want to indulge you for one moment. A very good friend of mine, I work in East Africa and Southern Africa, very good friend of mine who I've worked together for several years, volunteered to join the WHO effort in West Africa. He was working in Sierra Leone in a hospital, and the nurses had walked out. There were five physicians, all from various parts of the world, trying to care for over 120 Ebola patients. Unfortunately, he gave this wonderful frontline review of what was happening on a Thursday morning, our international call. Friday, he became fatigued. Saturday, he developed a splitting headache. By Monday, he was diagnosed with Ebola. Tuesday, medevaced to Emory. He's the person whose name you don't know. They kept his name out of the press. But he is a wonderful young man. He almost died. The story is remarkable in that he medevaced an individual, a British physician, a nurse, and it turned out that nurse and he were typed. They matched types. And Emory flew that person from England and gave him convalescent serum, antibodies. And he was on death's door. I mean, they didn't think he was going to make it through the night. He got transfused. He survived. And the next day, 1 to 2 days later, he started making his own antibodies. And that's the key. Stay alive long enough to start making your own neutralizing antibodies. And he was discharged home on Sunday, so which is a wonderful story.
So the virus to become airborne or aerosolized. Can you straighten that out a little bit?
So Pardista Betty is this wonderful young investigator at Harvard, at the Broad Institute. And she had a unit that was already in West Africa, and they were actually researching Lassa fever. But they sequenced the first patient, and they have been following this virus, and it is evolving. It's very interesting that three viruses emerged, and now one has taken over. But in terms of, there's no evidence that this virus is airborne in the way that flu is airborne. I will say, though, that there's clear evidence for aerosol transfer of the virus happened in the Ebola Reston outbreak in the monkeys that never spread to humans. You can clearly see aerosol transmission from pigs to monkeys. And so most physicians working in conditions in West Africa, while not wearing a respirator, consider themselves in a danger zone of 3 feet. You know, like if a patient were to sneeze on you, that, you know, 3 feet, 6 feet back, you're probably less likely to get that kind. So these statements that Ebola is not, you know, spread by aerosol or airborne, I think they need to be tempered just a bit. But it is clear that the greatest infection is by exposure to bodily fluids, and that's the major, major, major way it's spread.
It's on? With all of this talk about Ebola, and with all of you representing neurology diseases in the heart and HIV, I'm very surprised, and this is less of a clinical question and more regarding cures, that the FDA there is not a drug, and when it does go to the FDA, how it's held up in the FDA and how political it has become in terms of Congress and how it affects the drugs that go out on the market. So I know all of you are in the discovery part of this, but I'm addressing the cure part and why so much of it is held up.
You know, I think some of the holdup is reflective, at least in my area, the Alzheimer's area, I think reflects the actual complexity of the situation. So there's a strong push on the FDA at the moment to accept changes in biomarkers, for example, signals on a brain scan or changes in protein levels in the cerebrospinal fluid, to be used as outcome measures instead of the actual cognitive measures to expedite certain trials. And on one hand, that does make sense because these signals may show up and may change before cognition does. But at the same time, we haven't absolutely proven yet in many cases that these biomarkers are truly predictive of what happens with the patient and their cognition in the long run. So there is a complexity that just makes them reasonably conservative, I would say. And they're also worried about the heterogeneity of many patient populations that go into clinical trials and so on. Now, at the same time, I feel that a strong push, as there has been from ACT UP and other lobbies in the HIV era, they went to the FDA and pushed very hard. We haven't seen quite that same level of activism in aging-related conditions, perhaps because of differences in the outlook of the, you know, population that is affected. And so I think that on one hand, there could be more and a little bit more aggressive leaning on the FDA. At the same time, there is a risk of jumping the gun and accepting something too readily and then paying the price later on. So I think it really is kind of in the balance, and it's a very difficult, complex matter.
Yeah, I think some of the difficulty in finding cures does lie with the FDA, but I choose not to emphasize that so much. I prefer to put the emphasis on the science. Art Levinson, who's a friend and well-known as being the CEO of Genentech through a very successful period there, has pointed out often to Genentech people and to others that if you can learn and tell a compelling biological story, you can make a drug and make a cure. And so I think the real answer lies, yes, we need to reform the FDA. Yes, it is a broken organization that's not up to the challenge. Yes, we could get expedited paths, so we should do that. But I think the real message for us is not just to go forward with a therapy that seems like a good idea, but to know the complete blueprint of the biology that underlies it. Go deeper into the story of how cells work and what goes wrong. And then you bring a compelling case forward. And if you have a compelling case with a big effect, it's going to breeze through the FDA. That's the solution I want us to go for.
The other thing related to that and to what Sandy's partly alluding to is that the pharma companies are the ones that have the money to be able to have the clinical trials that are then going to convince the FDA to approve a drug. And for example, in the case of this heart regeneration discovery that we've made, we found that we were unable to get any interest out of pharma companies because it was too early. The data are so compelling, it's so extraordinary, but they don't want to invest a single penny into moving that discovery towards a clinical application until they know it's going to work, until they know that it's going to be their next blockbuster. And so for that, what Sandy showed in his slide, moving from the $1 million to the $10 million to the $100 million, that's what we need to overcome somehow. And so that's why the trials in pigs that I was mentioning, it's expensive, but if we don't do it, if we don't show that it's going to work in something that's very similar to us, not a single company, not even a biotech, is going to be interested. And that's the real challenge that we face at this moment.
One
One more comment about that. Warner told this amazing story of learning that HIV kills cells in a mechanism that we didn't know before, and there's a drug out there that appears to prevent that. Vertex is a fine bio company. A good friend of mine is their CEO. They're the ones that have pioneered treatments for cystic fibrosis. They do a lot of good in the world. But they say to Warner, you find the money. You find the money. And once you've done that, then we'll come in. That's the problem. That's that gap I showed you between our knowledge assets and getting across that line. And that's where we have to be creative and find better ways to do it. And those will help us do it.
Actually, what you're just talking about is really my question. How do you take all these compelling knowledge assets that you're developing along the bottom line and push them up the capital food chain and market them somehow to Johnson & Johnson or other biotech and pharma?
Well, I'll let Lennart start with that one. I think what you've heard here are some of our efforts to do that. We are getting some traction on it. We are getting some knowledge assets across that line with companies, but it's a continual uphill struggle. And the current processes that give us the resources that we need through NIH don't fuel that. We have to work to find other means of support to drive those assets up the line.
So we've been able to initiate some, I mean, to begin to build an engine that can help in that process with some philanthropic support. So, for example, in my area, the Stephen Bechtel Foundation has given us resources to create, to build a translational group and put some infrastructure in-house where we have some high-throughput screening devices, where we've brought people with chemistry knowledge in, where we now have folks who have extensive experience in industry who help us develop some basic assays for some basic drug screening that gets us to a level where we have a compound that in principle does what we think should work on a larger scale later. And so what we're doing is we're doing risk defrayal. We're demonstrating more and more, whether that is going from mice to pigs or it's going to go from a target to an actual compound that engages the target. We're bringing it up the level where the company becomes more attracted to it because there's more evidence and less risk. And so we've built a cadre of folks who have a lot of knowledge about this risk defrayal process, and we would love to expand it. But again, as Sandy said, that is not something that is supported by the typical NIH mechanism, and we rely on private support to make that happen. But it has turned out to be incredibly effective. So, for example, the drug trial that I was talking about earlier on and the engagement of two large pharma companies would not have happened without the development efforts that have occurred in that particular mechanism.
I just want to make a case for us. It was wonderful that a drug existed. And in fact, I think that there should be attention given to repurposing existing drugs that we need. In your case, there was an existing drug, an anti-epileptic, that might have a new application. So we have to be prepared for that. And circling back to Ebola, you know, the reason people die in Ebola is that that one of the proteins of Ebola influences their monocytes to create a cytokine storm, and basically they go into shock, hypovolemic shock. That same process, I think what it does, it involves pyrotosis. And I think, you know, if we could do it, I would be doing a caspase 1 inhibitor trial in that viral infection. So there's an example of what we've learned from HIV may have application to other viruses, because it's all a battle between the host and the virus. And there are similar pathways shared amongst viruses.
Let me make one more point, and I might ask Benoit to comment on this too. Since we can't change Congress and we can't change the risk aversion of investors, What can we change? Well, we can change ourselves. You know, we can think about our own practices and how we might more effectively drive those arrows up the chain. And you've heard some approaches to that. You've heard Lennart say, we form teams. Teamwork isn't rewarded in academic research most of the time. It's contrary to the time-honored culture by which professorships are earned and things. So we have to go against the grain and do unorthodox things. Lennart is doing that. Warner's doing that. Benoit's part of a project that some of you know about that we've called Biofulcrum, which is all about team building to attack big problems in medicine, mostly trying to create the knowledge that will drive those things up the chain faster. So write your congressman, you know, do those things. In the meantime, we're doing everything we can by changing our own practices.
Well, I think that the concept of the team is indeed sort of a new one in biomedical research, but it's one that's really, really effective. And I think more and more the mindset at Gladstone is that we need to come together and pool our resources, both intellectual and financial, and generate these groups of folks that are really going to work together. And so far, we're already seeing the fruits of that. It seems to be working.
I think we're going to have to wrap up after this.
I think working on cures, of course, is fantastic. But I'm very curious, as a layman, on the non-viral, in other words, not Ebola, but the what I would call autoimmune diseases, like Parkinson's. I know people who get Parkinson's or ALS late in life. Do we have any idea why that happens? Why? Because they're the ones you have to cure, but why did they get it in the first place, autoimmune?
So there's very little evidence that Parkinson's or ALS is due to an autoimmune phenomenon. So I think in most cases it would be more likely a neurodegenerative disorder where there are genetic factors that may come together with some environmental influences. So in Parkinson's disease, there is some evidence for the effect of pesticides and certain environmental toxins. In the case of Alzheimer's disease, head injury is a big environmental factor that may contribute in some cases. But it's most likely the constellation of genetics and environmental factors. And I think that just as with heart disease, if you happen to have an inclination to high cholesterol, you should, you know, avoid eating, you know, high cholesterol foods and get on a statin to keep your cholesterol level down. We hope that there will be things that one will be able to do for people with propensities to develop Parkinson's and Alzheimer's disease that they can do early on. And one of those factors, for example, would be to basically invent a statin for bad ApoE. Just like there is good and bad cholesterol, there is good and bad ApoE, and that's what we're trying to do with one of our drug development programs so that people who happen to inherit the bad ApoE that really cranks up the risk for developing Alzheimer's disease could take that compound early on in life and avoid the risk that it imparts on a person.
In terms of autoimmunity, it is the Gladstone Institute of Virology and Immunology. And in fact, we are studying autoimmune processes. Type 1 diabetes, Melanie Ott, Eric Burden have a very active program there. Yesterday, I just heard the latest data from a collaboration between Shomi Sanjavi and Katie Pollard looking at inflammatory bowel disease, which is an autoimmune disease, as a genetic component, an immunological component, and interestingly, a component about the bacteria in your gut, the microbiome. And it's an interplay of all three of these factors that drives the autoimmune condition of inflammatory bowel disease. So we're learning more and more, and it's the power of Gladstone is that we are as integrated within floors as we are within the floor, as we're vertically and horizontally integrated, which is allows us to move nimbly on multiple fronts.
So I've heard that a combination of wine and cheese and interesting hors d'oeuvres is particularly good for the gut microbiome. Do you agree?
Sorry. That was going to be my line. And for the heart, of course, as well. Red wine, as we know.
So let's go invigorate our brains, our hearts, and our immune systems. Thank you.